as long as I'm in His will, as long as I'm walking in the Spirit of God, I am an overcomer. I can deal with anything that comes my way. The Bible says in Isaiah, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise up and stand against him. And so that means that I am now under the banner of God. And so whatever I come up against has to hit God first. And when it hit God, it may never hit me, because God is leading me. But I got to be following him. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I got to follow God through his will. And so Paul wants us to understand in these first six verses that there's a decision that we have to make. And again, the mindset is important. Who controls you? That's the question that you need to ask yourself. That's what he's talking to the church tonight. Who controls your actions? What controls your thinking? Where are your thoughts clear? Where are your thoughts leaning to? Are you leaning more toward, ooh, we that kind of thinking, or praise the Lord, that kind of thinking? But don't get it twisted. God knows the thoughts and intents of the heart. Mm-hmm. You can tell me, oh, praise the Lord, but you still be thinking, oh, we. Does that make
Amen.
Sense? So you can't hide your intentions from God, even though you can camouflage them from me. But to walk in the Spirit means that there are going to be some outward manifestations of what's going on the inside. That's my proof. That's why the Bible says, judge a tree by the fruit that it bears. Because the roots are going to determine what kind of tree it is. Mm-hmm. But the fruit are going to tell me what kind of tree it is. Amen?
Right.
And the roots determine how strong the tree is. And so Paul wants the church to be challenged in that the Jews and the Romans who have come to this point now of contrast and conflict, they don't have to go head to head anymore. Paul said, stop worrying about what the other guy is doing. I want to give you the principles and precepts of how to live a life pleasing unto God, and then it's your responsibility. Mm-hmm. But don't come back and tell me a junior said that I ain't going. No, it doesn't matter what junior says. I just told you that not only are you saved, but how you get saved. Mm-hmm. And so if you follow junior's format, then yeah, you end up where junior wants you to be.
Yeah.
But if you follow what I've given to you, then you're going to come out according to God's will for your life.
Amen.
And that's the meaning. That's what Paul means by what's controlling you. Who's controlling your mind? What's controlling your actions and your thought? And there are two trains of thought, spiritual and the flesh. There's no in between. Spiritual and the flesh. And what he says in this text is real. To be carnally minded is death, and to be spiritually minded is life and peace. So we move through verse number 6 and 7 to understand what Paul is saying. But then you get to verse number 8, and I'm almost done here. You get to verse number 8, and verse 8 is the turning point to the text, or at least this cluster of verses. Verse number 8 really redistributes Paul's focus from the individual and his or her sinful nature to that of God and his amazing power. So everything about verse number 8, 9, 10, and 11 is about the power of God. Remember, our focus is living a life beyond our capacity. And Paul introduces this same text with the statement that for those that are in the Lord, in Christ, you're going to have power. You're going to have the capacity to go beyond your flesh and function, operate, and live according to the Spirit of God. So he goes a step deeper in verse number 8. I love verse number 8, and I believe that's why the Lord gave it to me to read, is that verse number 8 simply says, so then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. He really leaves no room for misunderstanding. Because he's been talking about these two realms, these two trains of thought, He now gives them this direction that I got to move closer to the Spirit. But let's make it plain. Those that are not in Christ Jesus, those that are struggling and to deal with the flesh, those that are in the flesh cannot please God.
All right.
That's important for us to understand. The words here are strong. So then means but, which means that there's a contrast to what he just said in the previous verses. To be in, and that I had to spend a lot of time in that part of the text, to be in Christ Jesus or in the flesh. To be in the flesh means to denote a fixed position in place, time, or state. To be instrumentally, constructively, a relation of rest, intermediate between the point reached or entered and the point where action and motion proceeds. And that became meek for me. I don't know about y'all, but I still had to wrestle with that for a minute. That's what to be in the flesh means. I'm at a point, reach or enter, or I'm at a point where the action or the motion proceeds. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
To be in the flesh. So I'm moving forward in the flesh. That means that I'm doing things according to the flesh. That makes sense?
Yeah.
That I'm walking contrary to the spirit,
yeah,
if I'm in the flesh. And the word flesh simply means the body as opposed to the soul or spirit as the symbol of what is external or by implication the human nature, what is frail with its frailties, physical or morally, and passions or specifically the human being. So the flesh, I'm living in the flesh. I'm living according to my human nature. I'm more inclined to do the natural things than the spiritual things. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And so he says, if I decide to drop my bucket and live according to that level and that realm, guess what? I cannot please God.
Right.
Oh, that means something to me. Cannot, that means that means that says that's a bold statement. And the word cannot is a compound word. I looked it up and I tried to define its origin, but it's a compound word. And the two words are ooh, which means to is a negative adverb, which means to know or not.
Mm.
Know or not. Ooh. And then the other part of it is donahi, to be able or possible. So think about it. Donahi is to be able or possible. So if I cannot, the first part of it is not or no. And the other part of it is to be able or possible. So that means that I'm unable and it's impossible.
Mm.
Does that make sense? That's what the word cannot means. So when he says you cannot please God, you cannot, you're not able to.
Wow. All right.
You're not able to.
Wow.
Why? Because of the fact that the flesh is dominating your thinking. And when the flesh dominates your thinking, you cannot please God.
Wow.
I was just blown away by that. And really, as you got to verse number 9, it really begins to really turn the tables to help us understand what Paul is really trying to say. He says, but ye are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. He says, okay, I'm trying to help you here. You're the church. I've given you all these things about the flesh and sin, but that's not where you are.
Mm-hmm.
He says, as a church, you don't live in that spirit or live under that. You live in the spirit. And here's what he says. But ye are in the spirit, and not, you are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. If so be that the spirit of God dwells in you. So that's where the Holy Spirit comes in. So that means that when the Holy Spirit lives in us, to dwell means to inhabitate, to be out. If the Holy Spirit lives in me, that means that now I've been given the ability to do what? Live beyond my capacity. Not because I've gone to school, got a better education, have a great career, got a lot of money. That doesn't enable me to live beyond my capacity.
Mm-hmm.
What enables me to live beyond my capacity is the dwelling of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Without the Holy Spirit in my life, more importantly, in my heart, I don't have the capacity to please God.
Amen.
You remember what Hebrews 11:6 says earlier? Without faith, it's impossible to please God. So what Paul is now saying also is that without the Holy Spirit in my life, I can't even do the things of God,
mm-hmm,
let alone please God. So we got to be serious about the Holy Spirit. And the only way to get the Holy Spirit is to do what? Accept Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So if I don't accept Jesus, I can't get the Holy Spirit. If I don't have the Holy Spirit, I ain't got no help.
Right. Right.
I can't be running around the church talking about holy, 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 holy if I ain't got the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Because it can't happen, because I can't do the things of God. And what Paul is really pulling the church into is to make a decision about being real and being committed and dedicated to the things of God. He's saying, like I said the other day, we gotta stop playing church.
Mm-hmm.
Lives are at stake here.
Yeah.
People are dying not knowing whether they're saved or not. And the church is supposed to, in my opinion, be the voice of Christ.
Amen.
We're supposed to be sharing the gospel. We're supposed to be sharing the word. And the word is what gives people clarity of purpose. Without the word, they have no direction. So we got work to do. We got a lot of work to do.
Amen.
Paul says, and many will agree, that our capacity to live in, under, and through the will of God requires great effort. We've determined that tonight. And so I've also gone a step further to say that the definition of capacity is the ability or power to do, experience, or understand something. The ability. The ability, that means the capacity, means that I got some things that I'm able to do. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
I got some things that God has given me amen, to do work. But the frailties of my body will also determine whether or not I have the capacity to fulfill those things. You know what I'm saying? To take one step further, proverbial wisdom suggests that we lean not to our own understanding. So Paul goes a step further and points to the responsibility that we have as believers to surrender our lives to the Lord. You know how hard that is?
Mm-hmm.
As long as you are, you think you got it going on, it's hard to surrender to the Lord. And most people think we got it going on. But Romans 12:2, and without jumping too far ahead of this series that we're doing, Romans 12:1-2 simply says, in support of what I just stated, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, that you present your body, a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service, and be not conformed to this world, here we go, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is a good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. That there's a responsibility that you and I have to turn our lives over to God. And in turning our lives over to God, we also have to turn our minds over to God.
Mm-hmm.
And God is going to use our lives to do what? To expose the truth about what it means to live in the will of God. He's using us as vessels to confirm and to clarify for those that don't know and don't believe what it means to live in, under, and with, and through the will of God. So our work, if nothing else, is to be a vessel for God to use.
Amen.
To allow us to be seen of men, but yet not praised by men. To allow us to go through things so that men may see us, but understand that there's a God that we serve in our testimony, in our presentation of the gospel, our exposure of whatever word God has given us to share with other people. Those are the instruments that God's going to use for us to clarify and confirm what it is that he wants to do in their lives.
Mm-hmm.
But we have to have an understanding of what he's trying to do in our lives.
All right.
And that's hard for us to do if we are not fully dedicated and surrendered to the will of God for our lives. It's hard, but it's not impossible. And that's what Paul wants us to see tonight. So as we go up to the end of this, Paul urges the church to give way to the Spirit. I thought, wow, give way. Means that to let go. For years, we heard people say, let go and let God. It sounded real deep, spiritual and spooky deep, amen. And it was something that many people say they were willing to do. But Paul says it's not that easy.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the flesh. It's easy for angels. It's hard for angels to do.
Mm-hmm.
So you know if it's hard for angels to do, it's hard for you to do.
Amen.
But he says we can do it if we allow the Holy Spirit to come into our lives. Well, the Holy Spirit only comes, how? Through a relationship with Jesus Christ. So I can't just show up at church one Sunday and say I'm filled with the Holy Spirit and I have yet to accept Christ. Because I can't bypass Christ.
Amen.
To get the Holy Spirit. And I can have a Pentecostal experience, but my Pentecostal experience would be predicated on my willingness to embrace Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense? Because if I try to get close to God without Christ, I'm going to run into a whole lot of issues.
That's right.
And God wants to use Christ to help cover me in my wrongness or in my sin so that he can invite me closer. Amen. Without the blood of Jesus on my life, God does not want to see me. It's the blood that God sees that it allows me to get closer to God. That's why Jesus is important in my life. It's the Holy Spirit that God recognizes that allows me to draw closer to him. Because
mm-hmm.
he recognizes himself. Does that make sense?
Amen.
He recognizes his son. He recognizes himself. Now I'm justified. That's what it's called. In the Christian world, it's called justification. I'm justified now. I've been given access. Not because of who I am, but because of who Christ is in my life. And what the Holy Spirit is doing for me. It's got me on the right path. In order for me to connect with God the right way and live a life pleasing before him. And my God, that's important for me. I don't know how important it is for you. But no doubt, each believer's cognitive ability to make good choices is prompted by our desire to live according to the divine purpose and will of God. Your cognitive ability, your ability to process, think, follow instructions, is prompted by your desire to want to please God. And that's important for us to walk away with him. I love the Lord because He showed us that tonight. Mm-hmm. And more importantly, He now has given us another tool that we can use to draw closer to Him.
Amen.
So for that, we give God praise. Amen. Let's pray. Spirit of God, we thank you now for this time and privilege. Thank you for this opportunity to have been in this place, God. Thank you for just another step toward knowledge and truth and understanding and clarity and purpose. Thank you now, God, for helping us to see the light. Thank you, more importantly now, God, for allowing us the privilege to be able to serve in this capacity and to walk according to it, learn to walk according to your will for our lives. That the essence of our relationship with you is predicated on our desire to want to draw closer to you. To do that, we have to receive your Son, Jesus, and live according to your Holy Spirit. And I love you for that tonight. I love you because you thought enough of me to make way for me to do those things. You sent your Son, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit to guide me. And I am grateful for that. And whatever we do tonight, God, whatever we leave here with, God, we pray that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. God, thank you for the revelation that we cannot live and do for you within our own capacity. But when we choose of our own accord to live beyond our capacity, then there are greater works that we can do. And I look forward to those greater works. I look forward to being stronger. I look forward to being wiser. I look forward to walking according to, in, through, and with you in this next season. And I would just say to God be the glory for the things that He has done and what He's getting ready to do.
Amen.
These things we ask in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So we pray, we bless God tonight for the release in my spirit to your spirit that you can live according to God's will if you choose. If you choose to. And that choice is something that you're going to have to make. If not tonight, at some point in time. With that, you know, I want to challenge you to pray and ask God to line up with where He's taken us as a congregation. The urgency of our commitment is detrimental to the future of our ministry. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Because the invitation ain't gonna last long.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Amen.
And this is not gonna be the normal. Amen. But that's contingent upon our willingness to accept God's assignment and to reclaim, recover, and restore. If we walk away every week not going to follow through with what that purpose or that vision is, then we are getting further and further back, away from God's will. Part of that is just because we don't feel it. Amen. We ain't got time for it.
Mm-hmm.
We got to make time.
All right.
Every week, as I was telling someone today, the Lord has put me at yet another table to sit and to be a voice. And every time somebody asks me, how do you do it? It's only by His grace. But I live beyond my capacity.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I am. I desire to do the will of God. And because of that, He adds tables to my agenda.
Amen.
Not for my own personal glory, but so that the works and the will and the word of God will be made known and manifest.
Amen.
That's it. And I want all of us to experience that. So don't be mad with me. Amen. I'm down the street. And didn't I used to be our pastor? You sure did. He moved on. No, I ain't moving on. I'm going to pull y'all with me. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord has not released me from this congregation. He has empowered me to lead this congregation.
Amen.
And I'm excited about that. And I understood my experience today is confirmation that I'm in the right place.
Amen.
Nobody may not know what that means, but I do. Amen.
Amen.
I'm in the right place at the right time, and I've done some things and not done some things. And what this lesson has done is challenged me to go back and revisit some of the things decisions that I've made and not be afraid to put people in their place. That's it. Because I'm not going to let anything come between us and God.
Amen.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
That makes sense. So praise God tonight for that. Tomorrow, not tomorrow, Friday at